इंट्रोडक्शन से करते हैं। इंट्रोडक्शन नाउ लेट अस स्टडी अबाउट द टॉपिक सम बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ केमिस्ट्री। नाउ द नेम इटसेल्फ इंडिकेट्स दैट देयर आर डिफरेंट कॉन्सेप्ट्स विच आर बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्सेप्ट इंक्लूडेड इन दिस टॉपिक्स द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट्स ऑफ केमिस्ट्री। नाउ फर्स्ट कॉन्सेप्ट दैट इज एलिमेंट। नाउ व्हाट इज एक्चुअली कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ एलिमेंट? रिमेंबर इट इज ए प्योर सब्सटेंस, ए प्योर सब्सटेंस, 100% प्योर सब्सटेंस विच कैनॉट बी फर्दर डिकम्पोज, cannot be further decomposed. So pure substance which cannot further decompose by ordinary physical or chemical method, by ordinary physical or chemical process. So that is element. Element must, it must be 100% pure, and so it cannot be further decomposed into, sorry, it cannot be further decomposed into simple substance by physical or chemical process. Now there are, you know, that in periodic table there are near about 180 different types of elements. Now then there are types of elements. Types of elements. Now, first type of element that is metals. You know that in periodic table, there are four types of particular elements are classified. First type of element that is metals. Now, which elements they are considered as metals? You know what are the characteristics of these metals? And so, if we observe the particular characteristics of metal, then first the characteristics of metal, remember these elements generally at ordinary conditions, they occur as solid. And so, they exist as solid. They are solids at ordinary condition. At ordinary condition. So metals exist as solid at ordinary condition. Second characteristics of metals, they have uniform and non-directional. Uniform and non-directional. They have uniform and non-directional. Strong metallic bonding. Yes, then third, they have high melting and boiling point. They have high melting point and boiling point. Now, then the fourth particular characteristics of metal, they are good conductor. They are good conductor of, metals are good conductor of heat and electricity. Now, basically, you know that. So, these particular types of elements, metals, now, why they are good conductor of heat and electricity? Now, the basic reason behind this. So, metal consists free electrons, that is, delocalized electrons or free electrons in its crystal lattice. And for the conduction of electricity, free electrons are required. And thus, as metal consists free electrons in their crystal lattice, remember, they are good conductor of heat and electricity. Now, the fifth point, they are malleable. They are malleable and ductile. So, metals are malleable and ductile. Now, what is malleability and ductility of metals? It means, remember, as metal consists strong, uniform, non-directional metallic bonding, it is observed that metals can be easily converted into thin sheet as well as into long wires. And thus, this property of metal to convert into thin sheet and wires, that is malleability and ductility of metal, this is due to presence of uniform and non-directional metallic bonding in metals. Now, that sixth point related to metal. This shows metallic luster. Metallic luster. Now, metal, it has some, again, these important characteristics, they show metallic luster. Now, what is this metallic luster property of metal? Now, you know that already metal consists free electrons, mobile electrons, delocalized electrons in its crystal lattice. Now, then what happens when particular metal it is cut by a particular instrument? Then it is observed that when a beam of light falls on metal surface, then it is observed that free electrons, delocalized electrons, they absorb that light energy and metal goes to excited state. And by absorbing energy, when metal goes to excited state, then, but remember, excited state of, sorry, that electron goes to excited state, but excited state of electron is always unstable. And thus remember, to achieve stability, that excited state electrons comes back to ground state. And when that electron comes to ground state, remember, when they radiate energy, and that, remember, that is metallic luster. So this radiation of energy by the electrons from excited state to ground state, this is the metallic luster of the metals. Now, then seventh characteristics of metal, correct? Seventh characteristics of metal, remember, generally they form basic oxide. They form basic oxide. Now, generally, oxides of metals are basic in nature. Now, then what is actually concept of this basic oxide? Remember, these oxides, when dissolved in water, they form a corresponding base. And when these oxides, when react with acid, they form salt and water. And thus remember, this property of oxide to form corresponding base in presence of water, and they can neutralize acid. Remember, these are basic oxides. For example, simple, remember, sodium. Sodium, it is a metal. Now, sodium forms an oxide, that is Na2O, it's formula. Now, when this oxide reacts with water, remember, it forms a base, that is sodium hydroxide. Sodium hydroxide is the basic compound, is the base. because you know it produces OH minus ion in aqueous solution. And according to RNACV, a substance which produces OH minus ion or which dissociates into OH minus ion in presence of water as a solvent, that is basic compound. And just remember, as sodium oxide which forms a sodium hydroxide in presence of water, the sodium oxide is basic in nature. Or second reaction, so this oxide, so when react with acid, then it forms salt. So it gives 2NaCl plus H2. And thus remember, this basic oxide, I mean this oxide, it can neutralize acid, giving salt and water. Thus it is a basic oxide. Thus remember, generally metals forms a basic oxide. The strength of oxide is different, but the nature is basic. So these are some common criteria, common characteristics of the first type of element, that is metals. Then second type element, that is non-metal. Now, generally it is observed that these types of elements, remember, they exist either solid or in gaseous state. At ordinary conditions, remember. Then, second, they have relatively low melting and boiling point as compared to metals. So they have low melting point and boiling point as compared to metals. Now, generally, bonding in case of these non-metals, it is covalent. They consist covalent bonding, Now, basically they consist covalent bond. This bonding is intramolecular. Now, this bonding covalent bonding, but it is intramolecular. Now, intramolecular, the non-metals consist intramolecular covalent bonding. It indicates that in a molecule of non-metal, remember, in between two atoms, there is a presence of covalent bond. Intramolecular means bonding between two atoms in molecule. Bonding between two atoms in molecule, that is intramolecular. And thus it is observed that in case of these molecules of non-metal, for example, let us consider molecule of nitrogen, that is N2. We consider molecule of oxygen, that is O2. Now, you know, these are at ordinary condition, they are gases. But if you observe, now nitrogen and oxygen, no doubt, they are non-metals. Now, nitrogen N2, so N triple bond N. So, there is a triple bond between two nitrogen. Now, why there is a triple bond between two nitrogen atoms in N2? Now, this is related to the electronic configuration of nitrogen. So, nitrogen atomic number is 7. And so, its electronic configuration, that is 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, 2py1 and 2pz1. So it is observed that in the outermost shell of nitrogen, consists total 5 electrons. But out of that 5 electrons, remember, 2 electrons are paired, but 3 electrons are unpaired. Unpaired means single electrons. And thus remember, according to valence bond theory, number of covalent bond formed by atom is equal to number of unpaired electrons present in last shell, present in valence shell of atom. And so as nitrogen consists 3 unpaired electrons, there is a triple bond between 2 nitrogen atoms. So whereas oxygen, O double bond, oxygen O2, there is a O double bond O. Now again, remember, oxygen atomic number is 8. So if we observe configuration, 1s2, 2s2, 2px2, 2py1 and 2pz1. And so on the basis of this electronic configuration, it is observed that last shell of oxygen consists total 6 electrons. Last shell, outermost shell, it consists 6 electrons. Out of 6 electrons, only 2 electrons are unpaired. 2 electrons are single. And thus remember, one oxygen, it can form a double bond with another oxygen. It means there is a double bond between two oxygen atoms in oxygen molecules. And thus remember, so this bonding, N triple bond, N oxygen double, O double bond, O, this is a intramolecular bonding. And thus remember, non-metallous consists intramolecular covalent bonding among themselves. Then non-metals are poor conductors. Remember, they are poor conductors of or they are bad conductors of heat and electricity. Poor conductors, or in some cases they are bad conductors of heat and electricity. Heat and electricity. Now again, some non-metals, they are bad conductors. You know that. Now why are they not? They are bad conductors. Again, due to absence of free electrons, all last shell electrons, they are used to form a covalent bond. They are bad conductors. But in case of some non-metals, they are conductors. Some non-metals, they are conductors. For example, if we consider carbon. Now, actually, in case of carbon, if there are diamond carbon, there are graphite carbon, there are fullerene carbon. These are the three types of this carbon. So now diamond is bad conductor of electricity, because in case of diamond, all last four electrons, remember, they are strongly used, all last four electrons, they are used to form four covalent bond. And thus remember, there is absence of unpaired electron, and thus diamond is bad conductor. But if we observe the second form of carbon, that is graphite. Now what is basic difference between diamond and graphite? Remember, in diamond, carbon has sp3 hybridization, but in graphite, carbon has sp2 hybridization. In diamond, carbon has sp3 hybridization. In graphite, carbon has sp2 hybridization. Now, sp3 hybridization means, remember, all last four electrons present in 1s and 3p orbitals of carbon, they are used to form four covalent bond. So it is bad. But in case of graphite, it is a sp2 hybridization. You know that atomic number of carbon is 6, and so its electronic configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2px1, and 2py1. It means, remember, out of now last shell of carbon consists actually of 4 electrons. Now, then it is observed that at excited state 1s2, 2s1, 2px1, and 2py1. Remember, and 2p1. So this is excited configuration of carbon. Now it is observed that in case of graphite, as it is, there is a sp2 hybridization of carbon, then this 1s orbital, it means this 2s orbital, and this 2px and 2py orbitals of carbon, they undergo process of mixing and reclustering. They form 3 hybrid orbitals, and by using that 3 sp2 hybrid orbitals, one carbon forms a 3 covalent bond with 3 carbon atoms. But these last 2 p hybrid orbitals, because it is a sp2 hybridization, so last 2 p hybrid orbital of carbon remains in pure bond. And thus it is observed that in the crystal lattice of graphite, it is observed that one carbon present in upper layer and one carbon present in below layer, remember, they form a pi bond by using that electron present in this pz orbital. And so that is, by the sideways overlapping, there is a formation of pi bond. And you know that as a pi bond is bigger than sigma bond, that pi bonded electrons, they are loosely held here. And it is observed that, remember, so by using this electron present in pz orbitals, that, remember, that carbon in the form of graphite, it conducts electricity. So this is basic difference between graphite. So remember, no doubt it is a non-metal, but remember, we are still using that graphite is conductor, but diamond is better properties. And so this is one of the characteristics, that is, they are poor conductor or bad conductor of heat and electricity. Then generally, these non-metals, they form base acidic oxides. Remember, they form acidic oxides. So oxides formed by the non-metal, generally they are acidic in nature. Again, now why they form acidic oxide, why they are, their nature is acidic, then it is observed that these oxides, when react with water, they form corresponding acid, whereas these oxides, they neutralize corresponding base. As they neutralize corresponding base, into giving salt and water, remember, the nature of the oxide is acidic in nature. For example, you know that sulfur, chlorine, they are not metals. Now, oxide of sulfur is sulfur dioxide. Oxide of chlorine, it is chlorine heptoxide. Now, if we observe the nature of sulfur dioxide and chlorine heptoxide, it is acidic, because sulfur dioxide, it forms a sulfurous acid. SO2 plus H2O, it gives H2SO3. And then remember, SO2 plus H2O gives H2SO3, that is a sulfurous acid. And as a sulfur dioxide, it forms a sulfurous acid. Remember, the nature of SO2 is acidic. Whereas Cl2O, when react with water, it gives 2HClO4. It means the name of this acid is perchloric acid. And thus remember, chlorine heptoxide is acidic because it forms a corresponding acid, that is a perchloric acid. And thus the nature of oxides of non-metal, generally that is acidic in nature. Then third type of elements, that is metalloids. Now, some elements, particularly elements present in 14th group of the periodic table, they are metallic metalloids in nature. For best example, that is silicon, germanium. So they are metalloids. Now, why they are considered metalloids? Remember, in presence of highly electropositive elements, highly metallic elements, they show non-metallic nature. Whereas in presence of highly electronegative element, in presence of not highly non-metallic element, they show electropositive nature, metallic nature. And so they show both the properties of metal and non-metal. And so they are metalloids in nature. It means they show metallic as well as they show metallic as well as not metallic properties. In presence of highly non-metallic and highly metallic elements. And thus remember, as they exhibit both the properties of metal and non-metal, remember, they are metalloids. For example, remember, silicon. Now, element present in 14 group is silicon. Now, it shows both the properties, metal as well as non-metal. In presence of highly electropositive elements, it acts as a non-metal. And in presence of highly electropositive, it shows non-metallic in nature. But in presence of highly electronegative or more non metallic nature, it shows the electroposite nature. Now, how it shows both the properties? For example, silicon, it shows the plus 4 oxidation state. Silicon, it shows plus 4 oxidation state when it combines with oxygen. Now, oxygen is highly electronegative element, highly non metallic element. And so, in presence of oxygen, silicon shows plus 4 oxidation state. And thus, remember, as it shows plus 4 oxidation state, it is the property of metal. Generally, metal shows positive oxidation state in compound. Whereas, in presence of Mg2Si, magnesium silicium, so silicon, it shows minus 4 oxidation state. And thus, remember, in presence of highly electronegative element, highly non-metallic element, it shows the properties of metal, and in presence of highly electropositive element, it shows non-metallic nature by showing negative oxidation state, and thus it is a metalloid. Now, then fourth type element, that is inert gas. Inert gases. Now, in periodic table, there is an 18th group elements. 18th group element. The element present in 18th group, they are inert gases. Now, different inert gases. First is helium, then neon, argon, krypton. So, all these elements, they are present in 18th group of the periodic table. So, they are inert gases. So, these are fourth type of element. Now, why they are inert gases? So, if we observe that atomic number of helium is 2 and its electronic configuration is 1s2. Whereas atomic number of neon is 10, its configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p6. Atomic number of argon is 18, its configuration 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6. Now, then it is observed that, remember, in case of this inert gas, the first element, that is helium, there is that atomic number is 2, it means atom of helium consists only 2 electrons. And thus remember, it consists only one shell, that shell is completely filled by 2 electrons. And thus, duplet is completed. Whereas in case of other inert gas elements, neon, argon, krypton, it is observed that last shell consists 8 paired electrons. It means in case of other inert gas elements, octet is completed. And remember, according to octet rule, if element they have either completion of duplet or completion of octet, remember, they cannot take part in chemical reaction. They are chemically inert, and hence remember, these elements, they cannot take part in chemical reaction. They cannot form a bond with another element. And thus, remember, they are chemically inert. This is the basic reason why they are considered as inert gases. Now, that the next basic concept, that is atom. Now, how will you define atom? Simple concept. How will you define atom? Remember, the smallest particle of element. Smallest particle of element which may or may not have free existence. May or may not have free existence. And so, smallest particle of element which may or may not have free existence, that is considered as atom. Now, why is considered that? It is a smallest particle because it is considered that atom further cannot be divisible, it cannot be further divided. But remember, actually it is not 100% correct. Further experimentally it is proved that atom is further divisible. It consists of smaller particles, that is electron, proton, neutron. But it is considered that, but as it is further divisible, there is some smaller particle present in atom. But if we define atom in the case of element, the smallest particle of element which may or may not have free existence. Now, why may or may not have free existence? Now, for example, there are metals. Now, metals exist as atom. You know, metal exists as zinc, sodium, magnesium, aluminium, they exist as atom. Whereas, inert gas, they also exist as atom. And thus remember, these metals and inert gases, they exist as atom. And so, the smallest particle of these elements, remember, they exist as atom. Whereas, there are some elements which exist in the form of molecule. For example, if we consider nitrogen exists as a molecule, as N2, whereas oxygen, it exists as O2, remember. And so, nitrogen, oxygen, they exist in the form of molecule. And thus remember, these smallest particle of element which may or may not have free existence, it means atom of nitrogen cannot exist as atom, but it exists as a molecule. Whereas atom of oxygen, it exists as molecule. And thus remember, smallest particle of element which may or may not have free existence, that is considered as atom. Now, then, we know that what are the corresponding fundamental particles of atom? Fundamental particles. Fundamental particles of atom. Now, what are fundamental particles of atom? Experimentally, it is observed that every atom consists of main three particles, that is, electron, proton, and neutron. So, these electron, proton, and neutron, they are considered as fundamental particles, or they are also considered as subatomic particles of atom. What are subatomic or fundamental particles? It means these particles which constitute atom. Particles which constitute atom, they are considered as fundamental or subatomic particles. So they are electron, proton, and neutron. Now, then, experimentally it is observed that these particles, they have also certain definite fixed mass. So, mass of one electron, it is definite, so it is equal to 9.1 into 10 raised to minus 28 gram. So mass of one electron, it is 9.1 into 10 raised to minus 28 gram, or in terms of atomic mass unit, so which is equal to 0.00055 atomic mass unit. So this is mass of one electron. Now if we consider mass of one proton, mass of one proton, which is equal to 1.672 into 10 raised to minus